Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. Welcome to this episode of Bible Talk with Brother Luke. Today I'm continuing the study of the book of Ecclesiastes. I'm going to pick up where I left off last time. And so let's start with chapter 9, verse 1. If you have not seen the previous studies on Ecclesiastes, they are available on my YouTube channel, Sin City Preacher. I hope you will go back and watch it from the beginning. All right, now I'm a KJV firstist, so I will read it first in the KJV, and then sometimes I look at it in the Amplified if I think it may be helpful. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 1. For all this I considered in my heart, even to declare all this, that the righteous and the wise and their works are in the hand of God. No man knoweth either love or hatred by all that is before them. Okay, and in the Amplified it says, for I have taken all this to heart, exploring and examining it all, how the righteous, those in right standing with God, and the wise and their deeds are in the hands of God. No man knows whether it will be love or hatred. Anything awaits him. Well, I guess we can all say from our own experience that's been true in all of our lives, hasn't it? We just don't know what awaits us. Sometimes big surprises are, we wake up one day, everything seems great, and then all of a sudden, a surprise you didn't count on. Sometimes they're good surprises. Sometimes they're bad surprises. So verse 2 says, all things come alike to all. There is one event to the righteous and to the wicked, to the good and to the clean and to the unclean, to him that sacrificeth and to him that sacrificeth not. As is the good, so is the sinner, and he that sweareth as he that feareth an oath. The Amplified says it this way. It is the same for all. There is one fate for the righteous and for the wicked, for the good, for the clean, and for the unclean, for the man who offers sacrifices and for the one who does not sacrifice. As the good man is, so is the sinner. As he who swears an oath is, so is he who is afraid to swear an oath. Well, I guess I'll mention again, for those of you who are not aware of this, that the book of Ecclesiastes is written by King Solomon. He's also the writer of the book of Proverbs. And I completed a complete study teaching of the book of Proverbs recently. Those videos are available on my YouTube channel, so I hope you'll watch that. But the point of the book of Proverbs is to teach us wisdom. Also, I completed recently a study of the book of Job. All of those videos are available on my YouTube channel, so I hope you'll watch that. But the reason I'm mentioning it is that in Proverbs and throughout the Bible, we learn of a principle that if you do the right thing, you're going to get good results. Paul talked about it. Jesus talked about it. It's called reaping and sowing. So if you're a diligent person, you wake up early and you go to school, get a good education, and then you work real hard in your career, chances are, because of all that sowing, all that hard work you put in, you will reap good things in your life. You'll be successful. Same thing applies when it comes to health. Most people, if they really conscientious about working at getting good health by eating properly, getting exercise, doing all the right things, chances are that they're going to be healthier than someone who neglects those things. This is reaping and sowing. In years past, I've referred to it as the law of reaping and sowing. But as I studied the book of Job, I realized that it was a mistake to refer to it as a law. And that's why I'm mentioning this now. Here in Ecclesiastes, we're seeing that same things happen to the good person and the evil person. You know, to the guy that's doing all the right things and the guy that's doing all the wrong things, same kinds of things happen to them. And the best example I can give you is Job. Job did everything right. His life was like the best example. That's why God selected him for Satan to examine as an example of the very best of mankind. And yet, even though he was so good, bad things happened to him. You've probably experienced this in your life, or you know people that you can cite as examples of this. There's a saying, why do bad things happen to good people? Because we know that the principle of reaping and sowing is, if you do good things, you're going to get good results in your life. And yet sometimes it's not the case. And there's a verse that, it rains on the just and the unjust. Now, the rain could be a good thing if you want rain for your crops. It could be a bad thing if it's rain that causes flooding. But regardless, the good people, the bad people, now no one is truly good, as Jesus said, only God is good. But I'm talking about goodness relatively, and by the way man judges goodness. We all see that looking at other people, that it seems that some people are better than others as far as they're kinder, more honest, and so on. It seemed like the relatively good people, sometimes bad things happen to them, and the relatively bad people, or even the outright evil people, sometimes good things happen to them. So this principle of reaping and sowing is generally true, but not absolutely true. That's why it cannot be called a law. And so that's what it's saying here. In Ecclesiastes, it says that it's all the same. As is the good, so is the sinner, and he that sweareth as he that feareth an oath. The same kinds of things happen to both. Verse 3, KJV says, this is an evil among all things that are done under the sun, that there is one event unto all, yea, also the heart of the sons of men is full of evil, and madness is in their heart while they live. And after that, they go to the dead. I'm also in the middle of doing a series called What is the State of the Dead? I hope you'll watch that too. You may be surprised as to the state of the dead from the time we die until the time of eternity. What is the state? And then what is the state of the dead throughout all of eternity? You watch that series, and I would be surprised if you're not surprised by watching it. But the point is that everybody goes to the dead. Let me read verse 3 in the Amplified. It says, this evil is in all that is done under the sun. When the term under the sun is used repeatedly, and it just means all worldwide, everywhere this is true. This evil is in all that is done under the sun, that one fate comes to all. That's right. Death is waiting for everyone. It's inescapable. Unless you happen to be alive at the time of the second coming of Jesus and the resurrection, at that time, if you're alive, then you won't have to die. You'll be glorified. If you're a believer, if you're one who put your faith in Jesus Christ, then you will receive, your body will be transformed instantaneously into an eternal glorified body that will never get sick or die again. regardless of that, we know that death is waiting for every person, with the sole exception of those people who are alive at the time of the resurrection. This evil is in all that is done under the sun, that one fate comes to all, that is death. Also, the hearts of the sons of men are full of evil. As sons of men, that's all of us. We're all full of evil. The Bible says that the heart of man is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And so that's talking about all of mankind. That includes you and me. It's just part of who we are as human beings. The heart of man is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Now, you might see yourself differently. You might say, oh, I'm a pretty darn good person. That doesn't apply to me. But it does. It applies to all of us. It's just that, as I said earlier, when man looks at other people, we have this relativism, whereas we see that some people are clearly evil, some people are not so clearly evil, and some people are clearly good, and some people are not so clearly good. It's all relative. But according to God, the very best of man is like filthy rags in the sight of God. It says, also the hearts of the sons of men are full of evil, and madness is in their hearts while they live, and afterwards they go to the dead. So the way I like to phrase it, though, is that there's a methodology that many people have adopted in evangelism, where you ask the person, do you think you're a good person? Or do you think you're going to go to heaven, and why? And they say, well, I think I'm going to go to heaven because I'm a good person. And of course, some people would argue, well, you're not good. Only God is good. And of course, then you get this two different ways of seeing it. If you look at it the way man sees it, it's relative goodness. So you can say, well, I'm a pretty good person. But then if we look through the perspective of God, then only God is good, the Bible says. No one is good but God. You might have a hard time accepting that, because you think, well, I'm a pretty darn good person. But it says here that we're all full of evil, madness, and then we die. Verse 4 in the KJV says, for to him that is joined to all the living, there is hope. For a living dog is better than a dead lion. Well, obviously a lion is more admired as the king of beasts. People think of a lion as much more desirable and admirable as a creature than a dog. And yet it says that being alive is better than being dead, so much so that you're better off being a living dog than a dead lion. Let me read that in the Amplified. There is no exemption, but whoever is joined with all the living has hope. Surely a live dog is better than a dead lion. So it's better to be alive. I've had many people ask me, well, hey, Luke, how are you today? And my standard answer is, I'm fantastic. I'm 9.6 on a scale of 1 to 10. And that surprises people, because most people answer without thinking and just say, I'm fine. I'm fine. And what does that mean? But when I say I'm fantastic, it's kind of an outlandish statement. Say, I'm fantastic. I'm almost perfect. And they say, well, why are you 9.6 instead of a 10.0? And I said, well, because the only way I'll be a 10.0 is I have to die and be resurrected and go to heaven. And when I have eternal life in the kingdom of God, that's when it's a 10.0. So that's how I see it. And that's what I gained from studying the Bible. But many people, when I ask them, how are you today? They might say, I'm fine without thinking, or they might say, well, I'm above ground. At least they're not buried in a hole in the ground, dead. So they don't understand that if you're saved, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. To die is gain if we are saved Christians, someone who's trusted Jesus Christ for salvation. It's even better to be dead and then have eternal life in the kingdom of God. It's better. But for your typical person, they'll say, well, I'm just thankful I'm alive. That's because they don't have any understanding of the afterlife. Even if they do understand it to a certain extent, they don't understand that their state in eternity could be bliss and joy and happiness forever and ever, guaranteed to them if they'll just simply trust Jesus. And because they're not aware of that or refuse to do it, they have this bleakness. They don't have this joy looking at the future as the Jesus promises us joy and bliss forever if we'll trust him. Because they haven't put their faith in Jesus, their viewpoint is, well, at least I'm, how are you today? Well, at least I'm above ground. Let's look at verse 5 in the KJV. It says, for the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything. This is an argument for an unconscious state of the dead. If you haven't ever heard about that, that's another thing that's discussed in my series, What is the State of the Dead? When a person dies, do they immediately go into hell and have eternal conscious, eternal torment? Or do they, and that the saved people, do they immediately go to experience some joy in some other dimension of heaven and waiting for the bodily resurrection? Or do they die and then there is this unconscious state until the resurrection? Well, according to this verse here, it says the dead know nothing. So this is a verse that can be used to argue for the unconscious state of the dead. So in the KJV it says, for the living know that they shall die. We all know that. Doesn't take as long to learn that. Maybe you're 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 years old and then you're finally told the truth. Yeah. At some point we all get this truth taught to us that everybody's going to die someday. But the dead know not anything, neither have they any more a reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. So that could mean that their memory is forgotten. They are not thinking or have any conscious consciousness, or it could be the memory of them is forgotten because everybody eventually gets forgotten. There are some people throughout history that are really memorable and have secured their fame for all of the history of man. People know of a certain few people who are famous, and some people think that's how you gain immortality, through some great accomplishment, and the history books will record it and you'll always be remembered. But according to this verse, it says, for the memory of them is forgotten. Let me read this in the Amplified, verse 5. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing, and they no longer have a reward here, for the memory of them is forgotten. Okay, verse 6 in the KJV says, also their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished. Neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that is done under the sun. Very depressing thought. But a lot of people, particularly someone who's atheistic or doesn't believe that there's any conscious existence after death, that you just simply don't exist anymore, these people may not be upset by this because they've already reached a point of acceptance that you die and you just don't exist. There's nothing after death. Someone told me that the other day when I was golfing. I was teamed up with two people I didn't know, and I was telling someone how beautiful the day was, and it was perfect weather. And I said, the only thing would be better than this is when I'm in heaven. And he said, there's no such thing as heaven. You die and you're dead. That's it. And I didn't want to spoil my golf day by, getting into a theological arguments with an atheist. So I tried to ignore that. But this is what a lot of people think. So look at verse 6 in the Amplified. It says, indeed, their love, their hatred, and their zeal have already perished, and they will no longer have a share in this age in anything that is done under the sun. So this is really talking about when people die, that they just get forgotten. People forget about everybody eventually, except for that tiny few that are so famous. Verse 7 in the KJV says, go thy way, eat thy bread with joy, and drink thine wine with a merry heart, for God now accepteth thy works. The Amplified says it this way. Go your way, eat your bread with joy, and drink your wine with a cheerful heart, if you are righteous, wise, and in the hands of God. For God has already approved and accepted your works. All right, now let's look at this next verse in the KJV. Let thy garments be always white, and let thy head lack no ointment. Live joyfully with the wife whom thou lovest all the days of the life of thy vanity, which he hath given thee under the sun, all the days of thy vanity, for that is thy portion in this life and in thy labor which thou takest under the sun. It's kind of like the saying, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you may die. Just enjoy life while you have it. Verse 10 in the KJV says, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave, whither thou goest. So this portion of Ecclesiastes certainly can be cited to support that viewpoint of the unconscious state of the dead. Verse 11, I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill, but time and chance happeneth to them all. Wow. Interesting philosophy that Solomon is writing here. It's kind of like just fatalistic, and what's the point of it all? You might as well just enjoy your life as best you can, and random things are going to happen. Everything is not based upon how hard you work or how deserving you are. Not based on the merit system in this life. Sometimes you work hard and you don't get good things. It's all kind of like just random chance. Verse 12, for man also knoweth not his time, as the fishes that are taken in an evil net, and as the birds that are caught in the snare. So are the sons of men snared in an evil time when it falleth suddenly upon them. Yeah, suddenly it just seemed like you never know. Bible says, life is like a vapor. It appears for a short time and disappears. It says that God has appointed that that man must die once and then the judgment. So it is inevitable. Life will quickly pass you by. And I've noticed, I'm 65 now. It seems like every day just whizzes by. Weeks, months, years are whizzing by like that. It's amazing. If you're young, time seems to travel, pass by more slowly. I'm not sure if I can explain why it seems that way, but it sure does. And so your life just goes, passes by, and then we're all doomed, fated to die. And sometimes it comes suddenly. Sometimes it comes unexpectedly. Many times when I was out street preaching, I'll be talking to crowds of hundreds of people and an ambulance. You hear a siren. And everybody turns and looks and you see an ambulance driving down the road, right, racing down the road. And that's an immediate reminder that the person inside the ambulance did not expect to be there. Not today. Sometimes bad things happen suddenly. Sometimes death comes suddenly, unexpectedly. Are you ready to die? Are you ready to be judged by God? If God asked you, why should I let you into heaven? What would you say? Would you plead that you're a good person? If that's the case, God will say, depart from me. I never knew you. Is that shocking to you? Most people think that in order to go to heaven, it is determined by how good a person is. If you're good enough, you get to go to heaven. If you're not good enough, especially if you're one of those bad people, you don't go to heaven, you go to hell. But the Bible says the contrary. Our fate in heaven or hell is not determined by our own goodness. It's based upon our faith in the goodness of Jesus Christ. He was so good, he died for our sins. He's so good that he offers us eternal life in heaven as a free gift. When we put our faith in him for our salvation, instead of pleading to God, I deserve it, I was a good person, that's when God guarantees us you're going to go to heaven because you trusted the Son of God, the Savior, Jesus Christ. But so the question is, what happens if death comes suddenly to you? Are you ready? If I died right now, I'm absolutely certain I'm going to go to heaven. And it's not because I'm a better person than you. You might be a better person than me. According to man's judgments, according to man's standards, maybe you are. But thankfully, it's not determined by how good we are. Otherwise, the Bible says we all fall short of the glory of God. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And once you understand that we're all sinners, as I said earlier, that we're all wicked. Now, you might not want to accept that fact, but you better accept the fact that you could never go before God and argue that you're perfect. You've never done one thing bad in your life. Can you admit that? Well, if you could admit that you're not perfect, you could never argue to God that you are perfect, then you can... Then the next thing you need to understand is perfection is what's required. If you want to get to heaven based on your own merit, the standard you've got to meet is perfection. That's what the Bible says. And once we understand that it's impossible, we cannot live a perfect life, then we realize that we're in trouble and we need to be saved. We need to be rescued. And God loves us so much that he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, the Savior, to rescue us, to save us, to die for our sins. And if you put your faith in him, you're guaranteed you're going to go to heaven. Simply because you trusted Jesus rather than putting your faith in yourself. Verse 13, this wisdom have I seen also under the sun, and it seemed great unto me. There was a little cry, and few men within it, and there came a great king against it, and besieged it. I'm sorry, I misread that. Verse 14, there was a little city, not a little cry, I'm sorry. There was a little city, and few men within it, and there came a great king against it and besieged it and built great bulwarks against it. Now there was found in it a poor wise man, and he by his wisdom delivered the city, yet no man remembered that same poor man. As I said earlier, few people will be remembered throughout the history of the world. And then, of course, they're all forgotten, and the only thing that really amounts to anything is in eternity. Did you trust Jesus? If you did, then you promised joy and bliss and happiness and perfect health and living forever in paradise, the new heavens, the new earth. You promised all that because you trusted Jesus Christ. But apart from that, it says here, no, you, even this great man that rescued the city, he won't be remembered. Verse 16 said, then said I, wisdom is better than strength. Nevertheless, the poor man's wisdom is despised, and his words are not heard. The words of wise men are heard in quiet more than the cry of him that ruleth among fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroyeth much good. I want to read these final verses again in the Amplified. Verse 16, but I say that wisdom is better than strength, though the poor man's wisdom is despised, and his words are not heard, not heeded. The words of wise men heard in quietness are better than the shouting of one who rules among fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good. Well, that's all self-explanatory, I guess. That's the end of chapter 9. I'm going to pick it up next time, chapter 10 of Ecclesiastes. But first, let me finish this thought on salvation. I talked about it throughout this whole study. I usually end every video with the message of salvation, offering you the free gift of salvation. And if you've been paying attention, you know that man is in a futile, hopeless situation. We can never go before God and say, I've been perfect and I deserve heaven. You owe me heaven because I performed. I deserve it. Wait, no one can get away with that. You're going to have to humble yourself and say, I don't deserve it. I'm not perfect. I need Jesus. If you do that now, then when you die, you're guaranteed you're going to go to heaven. Now, why should you believe this? Because of the resurrection. Jesus said he would give us a sign to prove all of these claims are true, that he is God, that he came down from heaven, became a man, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, that he died on a cross to pay for our sins, and that salvation is offered as a free gift to everyone who trusts Jesus Christ. He says, I'll prove it. I'll prove all my claims are true. After they kill me and bury me, 3 days later, I'll raise myself back to life bodily. And that's what he did. The Bible says Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried on the third day, according to scriptures, raised from the dead. Now, there's historical records of this. There's proof that this really happened. Jesus walked on the earth bodily for 40 days after his resurrection, 40 days among 500 witnesses. They saw him. They talked to him, they touched him, they ate with him. And it's that bodily resurrection that is the proof that he is God, that he is our Savior, that he does have power over life and death, that you can trust him. Because God cannot lie, God cannot break a promise. Jesus promises you eternal life if you'll trust him now. Put your faith in him. No longer believe in your own ability to earn salvation. Do it now. And I hope you join me next time for my next broadcast of Bible Talk with Brother Luke. So bless you all in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus Christ.